Okay, so now we're being recorded, and so as part of this session, if you could keep your phones muted, this is, like I said earlier, this is the best way for us to keep the noise to a minimum so we can have a nice recording for folks to listen at a later time. So this is the last of our webinar series this year for new exhibitors and new families as it relates to the animal or food animal projects. And so in February and January, we started off with beef and we've transitioned to sheep and swine. And now we're on to the meat goat project here in May, right before the beginning of hopefully what will appear to be summer sometime soon. But anyway, we are going to get started with our speaker this evening. When he gets on board and hopefully on Blackboard and gets his phone going here, we do have Brian Ferris. He's going to be our speaker this evening, and he's the Extension Sheep and Goat Specialist at Kansas State. And so while he's getting on, I'm going to just go through a few of the slides that infuse a little bit of the information I guess I have for you this evening as it relates to this project. And if you are on the webinar, you can put your questions in the lower left box. There's a chat box down there. And if you have some questions through the evening or through the process, please go ahead and just jot down your questions there. At a certain point in the evening, we'll entertain questions via the phone. And if you've got questions, we'll entertain those at that time, okay? Also, if you could, if you're at a county, I see Grant County and Calumet County are on. If you guys wanna jot in perhaps how many students and people are in your location, that'd be great. And actually the rest of you, if you're at a location where there's a number of people on board, please go ahead and do that as well, okay? So we're gonna get started, like I had mentioned, with a few of just information from my perspective. The Meat Goat Project here in Wisconsin is growing in some counties. It's really grown exponentially, almost in a way larger than some of the sheep project numbers. But currently here in Wisconsin, we've got almost half or a little bit more than that of goats in the project as compared to sheep. And here as of the numbers that I saw here lately, goats are certainly just right there competing with the sheep numbers. So that's exciting. And certainly in other states in the United States have grown a lot more quickly as it relates to meat goat. But here in Wisconsin, that's kind of more of slower growth as compared to, you know, Oklahoma, Texas, other states that are very active. One thing to mention in terms of the food animals, the swine project is the largest of the food animals that I currently work with. It is actually larger than the dairy project and has been for about 3 or 4 years now. I think even more so this year than other years, almost 500 more exhibitors in swine than dairy. So it's definitely been a growth area in the food animals. Moving on, I just wanted to make sure that you were aware of our youth livestock website. Go to fyi.uwex.edu. / youth livestock, you'll come up to the website. That's a pretty important site for you to all kind of have in the back of your mind for information, resources, that sort of thing. So we certainly want you to have that. The purchasing.
Sorry, that's me, Bernie.
Okay. Just mute your phone, Brian, and then I'll finish up here and we'll put you on. So a couple of things I just wanted to kind of note before I had Brian join us is if you're a new person in the Meat Goat Project, certainly you have some logistics or some rules and policy that you'll want to be made aware of when you're looking to start this project in your county. And certainly pay attention this time of year. You should be getting your premium books, or the information is on the website for your county or any show that you might be interested in going to. Make sure you are reading the rules of the show, any specific paperwork you need to have in on time, all of that sort of thing. Make sure you're kind of keeping track of that. I know it's almost like keeping track of your kids' schoolwork and paperwork, but it's certainly something you'll be thankful for in the end when you followed all of that information. A couple of other things that you want to make sure you are aware of. Some counties do have identification for their meat goats or the dairy goats project. Some counties may not have that quite yet because their project numbers may not be that large. So think about that too. Pay attention to any kind of tagging sessions, checking in, project meetings that you want to attend. All of those types of things are great for learning more about your project and gaining skills on being successful. So kind of keep those things in mind. Some of you may be purchasing your animals, some might be raising them. Really, either way, animal health is really important, and I'm sure Brian will talk a bit more about this, but for sure get some information from people you might be purchasing your animals from, such as, what have they been vaccinated with? What have they been feeding? So you can kind of keep that consistent when you transition, and I'm sure Brian will cover this. If it's a purebred boar doe that you want to show as a purebred, or as a purebred wether, or any of those types of situations, make sure you've got the paperwork that it would need if that's so desired or needed by the show that you're going to. So just keep track of that type of paperwork and or information that might be required, okay? Those are probably the biggest things as it relates to your project. A couple of things that I just want to end on before I turn this over to Brian is, the meat goat project is new and fun and an interesting thing, but don't forget to make sure when you start a project like this, like with all of our projects, certainly set some goals for yourself on what you want to accomplish this year. What are some objectives of your project that you want to learn? What skill do you want to develop? Maybe you want to learn how to clip your goat or be successful in showmanship or learn more about how, goat reproduction works or nutrition, any of those types of things. Make sure you really, write those down and really think about what you've learned at the end of the year, because that's what these projects are about, for sure, to be able to exhibit and show what you've done, but also to learn about the project in and of itself or the animal, okay? So I think at this point, if Brian is ready, I think we're gonna move right over to really kind of the nuts and bolts of this. I've asked Brian Ferris, he's the Extension Sheep and Goat, Meat Goat Specialist at Kansas State, and he came up a while ago, a few years ago, and did a session for us here in Wisconsin, and he's a wonderful wealth of knowledge about the meat goats, and I usually try and beg and borrow him to come speak for us. So I will turn this over to Brian. Again, everybody make sure your phones are muted, and we'll have a nice clear connection of Brian and his information this evening. And Brian, I'll move your slides as you tell me, okay? Are you there, Brian?
I was. I forgot to turn my mute off.
Oh.
I turned my mute on or off, yes. So, yes. I apologize for not getting that off earlier, and so you hear my pickup ringing. And so, everyone, we I'm actually in a vehicle right now, not driving, so everyone can be rest assured that it is safe, but I'm doing this from a remote location. But anyway, as we go through this evening, and it's going to be pretty fast, as you can tell through the number of slides. There's 122 slides. There is no way we're going to spend a great deal of time on each particular slide. The ones we're going to focus on, obviously, are the important ones. And the main thing is, like this first slide shows here, it's a family project. This is a particular group that I had in North Carolina. We were all a big 4-H club, and it really became a lot more than, you know, just showing goats. That entire group there, believe it or not, we still vacation with now. And so it has developed more into a family than it has in just friends and showing goats. So this is a great project. Go ahead and let's go to the next slide there. So we'll begin talking about selection. And I think this is one of those things that everybody has to become familiar with the anatomy and the physiology of these animals. And so spend some time looking at this buck here. The one thing that I want to point out, especially as we look at 4-H goats, we want to really pay attention. I'm getting a little bit of feedback from the switch here. Is that better?
Yeah, this one's a little bit better. Yep.
Okay. So as we look here, I want you to focus right in behind this goat's shoulder, and you'll see the area called the rack. And that's one of the areas that we're going to really pay a lot of attention to when we come to evaluate that goat. You'll see a judge place their hand over that area, and they're really feeling for muscle expression and shape there. They're going to next hit that loin area, which is from the last rib back to the point of his hip. And that's, again, an expression of muscle. And then they're going to handle that goat. Well, I say they're going to handle him. They're going to look at him through his rump and through his hip and lower leg. Now, on goats, many of you have probably been familiar with showing lambs, and some of you may not have. But it's oftentimes seen that judges will grab a lamb's leg to feel how plump that leg is. That's something we typically don't do in the goat world, because when you grab that goat by his leg, that goat wants to squat. He wants to tuck his tail. And so they don't look good at that point. And so most of the time we evaluate them like we do steers and hogs, and just we put them on the move, and we can see how much muscle shape and expression they have through that leg. And then we're going to look at the rib. We want a real nice round ribbed animal. We don't want them extremely shallow bodied, but we don't want them extremely deep bodied either. We want them to be clean and smooth through their shoulder. And then you'll see up on the front of that goat's chest, you'll see his chest floor. This is an area that we want a lot of width between those front legs. But at the same time, we don't want that goat built like a bulldog. We don't want those legs to be outside and of his body, more or less, where those legs aren't right under his frame. Because if he's not right there structurally, he'll never be right. And we'll look at some pictures here as we go on down the line. But then the forearm, the area right above the knee, that is one of the areas, especially right now, that we're looking at young goats, and we're selecting young goats off for projects. We're looking at these animals, and they are not fully muscled like they will when they mature. And so we look for muscle shape where we can, and that's one of those areas on the real young kids that we'll see some muscle shape early on in their life. Okay, next slide. Sorry, my computer went to sleep. Okay, so as you go through, you've got to ask yourself some questions. How much experience do I have? Some of you, just in talking to Bernie, this is your first year, and that is perfectly all right. Obviously, we want as many people involved as we possibly can. And so if it's your first year, if it's your 10th year, you know, you can always learn something. I've been raising sheep and goats all my life. And I still learn something new. And so it's one of those, it's an ever-changing, ever-evolving program. And so you want to ask yourself, you know, that question of experience, because that may lend itself to, well, do I want to go out and buy the very best animal that if I don't have help in feeding him, or if I don't feel comfortable in my feeding program yet, it may not be the best thing to invest the most money in, you know, this goat that you think could be the champion at your state fair. So it's one of those things that you just have to kind of sit down and have that heart to heart with yourself. Where do you plan on exhibiting your goats? Do you know the rules? If you're going to show at your county, county oftentimes rules can differ from the state rules. The requirements may be a little bit different. And so familiarize yourself with those types of things before you go on. How many goats do I need? You know, I don't know for sure what you're allowed to show in Wisconsin, but for instance, you know, we can show two wethers and two breeding animals at our county fair. We can show three market animals at our state fair, and we can show two males and two females, or two wethers and two females at our other Kansas State show. And so kind of have an idea of how many animals you're going to need. Are those shows terminal? Our shows are not, so we can use those animals that we show at state fair later on, 2 weeks later at the next show. And so don't buy too many goats if you have the opportunity to reuse some of them. And then what is your budget? And this is the key. You know, I'm sure that y'all hear of these crazy people down in Texas that are spending $15,000, $16,000, $17,000 on a wether. This is crazy. You know, if he does not have the capability of reproducing, I don't know why you would spend $15,000 on it. But that's their prerogative. If they want to spend that money, that's fine. The only thing I'm upset is they're not giving it to me. So as we look at your budget, you know, figure out how you can stretch that, how you can buy the most goats for best bang for your buck. You know, can you spend $400 or $500 and get you one really good one, and then spend, you know, $100 and have a feeding buddy? So those are some of the things you might ask yourself. All right, next slide. So again, where should I get my goats? You can go straight to the farm and get them from the farm. There's so many online sales. The one thing I caution you is online sales. Most of these goats are fitted to a T. They look like they're going into a beauty pageant or the national show. So I really encourage you to, especially if you don't have a lot of experience, try and go to a producer and visit with them one-on-one, and I think that you'll get a lot more help. And then what size goat is best for my child? If you've got a kid that's 6'3", 220, you know, these great big boys in high school, they don't need to be showing a 50-pound goat. Be sure and get one that's going to grow and get big and stout, you know, 105, 110-pound goat. At the same time, if you've got a 9-year-old that weighs 50 pounds soaking wet, they don't need a 110-pound goat. They need one that's going to be somewhere 80, 85 pounds. And the thing that excites me so much about the Goat Project is these animals are really made for our little kids. You know, they can really handle these goats quite well. My son just started this year. I've got a daughter that's been showing now for 3 years. But he's 8 and he is loving these goats. And then have the goats been disbudded. Most of the time we try to disbud these kids when they're about 2 to 4 weeks of age. That way we don't have to worry about horns. Now, very seldom will you ever see this on your doe kids, because the way we look at it, or the way I look at it, is those females are going to have to return back to the farm and reproduce for that person. If we put them out on any type of pasture, and I'm sure you have coyotes just like we do, town dogs, things like that, that's how those goats defend themselves. However, they are also very good at getting caught in fences. So some people prefer to disbud their does just to prevent that method of getting caught. All right, next slide. Okay, so when we look at genotype and phenotype, this is more of a breeding type deal and really hardcore selection whenever you look at a breeding program. But genotype is what that animal should be, and phenotype is what he appears to be. But we have to use both to make the best decision. And to a certain degree, you'll see this because you'll look at sales and people will be saying, well, this weather is sired by so-and-so, who sired the champion at Louisville and the champion at Wisconsin State Fair and Ohio State Fair, and he's a good one. Well, just because this goat sired all these champions does not mean that everyone he sires is going to be a good one. So at the same time, the Kentucky Derby winner shows us that you don't have to have the greatest genetics to win. And so as long as you are capable of winning and performing, you can certainly be a winner. And so I think that's something that we have to really look at both of these things to make our best decisions. Okay, next question. Or slide. Okay, so a poor quality goat, I feel, will always be poor quality. And a lot of times I hear people say, well, I buy this goat, he doesn't look that good, but we'll exercise him and we'll feed him good and we'll do our best. If they don't start out with some quality, they will never have quality. Well, I say they won't, not never. That's a bad statement. But rarely will you ever find one of those goats that starts out bad that ends up better. So a high quality goat can always be ruined without proper care. So that's where we've got to get into some of this nutrition and health stuff later on in the presentation, and we'll talk about how we can best care for that animal. But as we look at that last point, a high-quality goat with a lot of work, proper care, and you got to have some luck, they can be a champion. And so we've got to combine those types of things to really get to where we need to be in the end. All right, next slide. So as we look at structural correctness, that head should be held erect. It never fails that whenever you're selecting livestock, the animal that grabs your attention is that one that's just proud of himself. He's got his head held high, that neck comes right out of the top of their shoulders, they stand and walk balanced. They've got a strong level top, especially right in behind the shoulders. We want to look at that area, we want to make sure that top line is very level and straight. That's something that has really changed over the last several years in the goat industry, that we've really been able to strengthen up these goats and make them better in that area. But oftentimes when you walk in a pen, that first one that grabs your attention is the one that has a real, all these types of things that really, really combine into a strong animal. All right, next. So we want them to have a long loin and a long hip. And this is something that we look at in most any livestock species. And I think those of you that are familiar with some of the other livestock species and as you kind of transition over here to the goats, as my dad always told me, he said, you may not be an expert in every species, but if you can see livestock, you can see any species. We're looking for a lot of the very same things in each of our species. So keep that in mind if you're coming from another project. But we want them to be long-loined and long-hipped. We want that hip to be as level as possible. Now, here's one of those cases, though. A goat, we've made them leveler than they have been in the past, but a goat is always going to have just a little more slope to their hip than what the other livestock species, and rightfully so. I don't think we should strive as breeders to make them tabletop level like we have in the sheep and in industry. I think that's something that we may have taken a little too far. But then we also want them to be heavy bone, heavy structured, and have a good strong pasture joint under them as well. Okay? All right. This picture, I want you to see where we talked about that levelness down their top and strength right there in that rack area. Now, granted, the goat up on the top left is bracing, and so that's going to make him look just a little bit better anyhow. But the black-headed goat on the bottom right, you can see that my red line, there's a lot of space under that red line. And then the levelness of their hip, the goat that's up on top that's being braced, he is leveler hipped than the goat down below. Now, one thing I want you to think about or notice here, and granted the depth of the photos is not the same, but recognize that the goat on the lower right, even though we've criticized him for being weaker down his top and steeper out of his hip, that he's still longer hip than the goat that's on top. So even though we can get down on some of these animals, generally speaking, there is usually one area that we can always find something positive to say or to see in one of these animals. Next slide. Now, as we look at young animals, we have some growth indicators. The length of cannon bone from their knee down to their pastern, the longer that is, the better off we are. And the length of their neck. Those are some real growth indicators. If you've got a goat that's short neck, short cannon bone, he's not going to be big as a minute. So we want to make sure that this guy is long cannon bone, he's long necked, and I think those are the animals that you'll see the most growth and development in the future. Now, also, as I mentioned earlier, we talked about muscle indicators and forearm and shape of that hip, and we'll talk a little bit more here in just a bit in terms of the shape of that hip. I think it'll be easier to see in the photo that's coming up. Go ahead. So as we look at muscle, structure, we have to have structure first. That's, you can't build a house without building a foundation. And so just recognize that structure is that animal's foundation. And as we start to come in and put the walls together and decorate things, that's going to be the muscle. And so we're going to ask for a real broad, thick rack and loin. Used to, if you had an animal that just had a big loin, you were in pretty good shape. But anymore, they better have a pretty extreme rack shape now. To really do well. And it's one of those things that I think as you gain more animals and gain more experience there in Wisconsin, you'll just see the quality get better and better and better. You want an animal that's firm in harsh handling. These goats have a tendency to always be a little leaner, and so they're not going to be quite as soft and to the handle as what we see in some of the other animals. We also want a deep, heavy, muffled leg. We want to see some thickness back in that leg. And then that stifle, as we look at the animal from behind, it should be the widest part of the leg. Okay, next. All right, as we look at these photos, the picture there on the left, and I think we used this part of these slides for when I was up there doing that program a few years ago, but I made the comment then that even though this picture is blurry, it probably helps this goat because he's that bad. He really has a tendency to hock in. If you look at the top of that picture, just barely, you can tell he's easy topped. And then as we transition, let's look at the two goats there on the right and focus on them. I hope that you can see the shape of these animals and how much thicker the animal is on the right than on the left. And as we look at that goat that's there on the right, if you talk about his pin set, which is just to either side of his tail, it's not out there at the point of the rest, whatever shape that is, but it's not out there on those corners. It's going to be right in there. That pin set's going to be on either side of his tail. The wider that pin set is, the better off that animal, the thicker he's going to get. The other thing that we talk about learning something all the time, and I've learned something from our pygmy goats a little bit, is they talk about the thurl. And essentially, it's where the femur hooks into the hip of that animal. And if I'm not correct, somebody can correct me on that, but that's the way I've understood it. And if you see that animal that is wider front, as he gets wider from the front of his hip back into that area of his thurl, that goat will get thicker and thicker every day of his life. However, if you get an animal that appears to be the same, I mean, he just transitions and does not get any wider as he works back into that area, that goat will always be a little lighter muscle. Okay, next slide. Okay, as we look at these four animals, A, B, C, and D, and granted, not all of them are standing just the best in the world, but what I generally try to do here is just try to go through and make some points here. I hope that you can see that the goat letter C is extremely steep in its hip. D is also the same way. D is very steep in its hip, but at the same time, that goat is carrying a little bit more natural thickness. The best animal from there, and in terms of hip and leg, though, is the A goat. So any of y'all that are looking at that and can recognize that A is the one to get around, that's good. However, I want you to study them at the ground. What is wrong with letter A? She's weak on her pastures. So not every goat is going to be, you know, flawless. I haven't seen one yet. And so as we look at these animals, I really encourage you, especially if we've got some folks in the room or listening tonight that are evaluators, that we don't single trait these animals, that we don't just kick them out because, you know, they're weak pasture. Or one thing or another. So be careful there. All right, let's go to the next slide. Okay, so we've been talking about muscle. We want those animals to be wide through their chest floor. They need to be powerful through their shoulder. A goat shoulder is really good to eat, so there's nothing wrong with putting some muscle on these shoulders. Now, we don't want them to be coarse fronted, so we want them to be smooth and clean over the point of the shoulder. We want the top of those blades to tie neatly and tight at the top of that shoulder where they lay in. You don't want it to appear when that goat walks that those blades are just about to pop out of the skin. Okay, you just want to see some movement, but ever so slightly. Just recognize that animal's laid in there really tight and those shoulders are working correctly. And then, again, as we talked about, that large forearm. Okay, next slide. All right, here's what we talk about just in terms of top line and rump and forearm. Those three photos, that's just kind of what we're looking for there. All right, next slide. Okay, width of chest. Now, this buck kid here on the left, he's really wide through his chest floor, and he's a little fleshier right now than the doe that's on the right. But I hope that you can tell, again, the depth of the photos. I need to work on these and make sure that these photos are taken from the same depth to really get this down well. But I hope that you can see that the goat on the left is much wider through his chest floor than the doe is on the right. Now, at the same time, I have seen goats that are so, for the lack of a better term, grotesquely fat. I mean, they are, somebody spent way too much money on feed because these goats have so much feed. And if you think that I'm talking about your goats and you're offended, I apologize, but kinda, you know, these goats, they don't need to be that fat. What we end up doing is we get these goats so fat that they do not have any choice but to have some width through their chest floor because they deposit so much fat around their sternum. And as you see these animals, if you've got an animal that is completely smooth and has no wrinkles in their foreflank, if you look at the animal from the front end, they don't have any wrinkles up to their front end. That goat is probably pretty fat. So just be careful. If you've got breeding females, that we get into some problems with ketosis and some other pregnancy-related diseases that we won't really focus on with this talk. But just avoid getting these goats too fat. All right, next slide. So as we look at these two goats, you can tell the squareness and width of that goat there on the left is so much better and more desirable than the goat that we have on the right. As you look at the animal on the right, because he is so narrow through the base of his chest, he's really flat ribbed, he's flat shouldered. There's not a lot of shape to this goat. And as a consequence, he's not going to have as much muscle. Okay? All right, here's a picture that we talked about forearm, and notice the vertical line that we have and then the horizontal line. I'm trying to look for the thickest part of that forearm, and that's what we found there in the, or as we look at that horizontal line. As we look at the vertical line, we're trying to see how much muscle is out there on that leg, because what we have is that goat's bone sits just to the left of our black vertical line. And so what we're looking at on the outside part to the right would actually be muscle. And so in this particular case, the goat in the top left corner has a great deal more shape to his forearm than what we see in the goat in the bottom right. Volume and capacity, I can't tell you how important this is, and not just for breeding animals, but also for market animals as well. But we just want an animal that has a good relationship in terms of body length, body depth, width. These animals are three-dimensional. They're not two-dimensional. So we need to make sure that we're keeping track of all of these things. Again, as we talked about, proportional, they need to be long body with adequate depth. We don't want them to get too shallow. We don't want them to get too deep. And then we certainly want them to have some spring and shape to that rib. If they don't have the proper shape to their rib, those animals are likely not to perform as well. It's been my experience as I look at animals that are flatter in terms of their rib design, they just don't convert near as well. Okay? Okay, here again, we see two goats, the goat behind. I hope you can definitely see his extremely flat rib, narrow up through their chest floor. The goat in front, much rounder in her rib design. She's got a good chest floor in her, very smooth in her shoulder. Just a really nice goat to look at there. Okay, next slide. Ultimately, whether we like it or not, we're going to a show ring. And the show ring, you've got to have some style and balance. How well do these body parts all connect? You know, I often kind of joke, you know, here we are, whatever that song is we used to sing, how the knee bone's connected to the leg bone and all that, it kind of goes through the same deal. How does that neck blend into the shoulder? How does the shoulder blend to the rib cage to the loin into the rump? And there's so many other parts here, but how does all of that connect? And when we put that animal in motion and we see all those moving parts, does this look like a well-oiled machine, or does it look like we've taken bits and pieces from animals and just shoved them together and tried to make the best goat we could, but not everything was made exactly right? And so we want to be careful there to make sure that you have that style and balance, because ultimately, you've got to have that look to draw the people's attention. Okay, next. Okay, that's just a picture of a couple of goats. Those were the two heavyweight divisions at Houston 1 year. One goat's racing, one goat's not racing. Both of those outstanding animals. Let's go to the next slide. Okay, there we go, style and balance again. Overall eye appeal, as we mentioned early on in the presentation, a goat with good style and balance will be the first goat that catches your eye when you walk in a pen. He says, here I am, don't look at anybody else, I'm the one for you. And so, you know, he's the one that you really need to look at. Goats to avoid, any of you that have ever watched me judge know that I do not like short-bodied, shallow-bodied, narrow-based, bulldog-fronted, flat-ribbed, very mature and kind of goats. And, you know, there again, I've seen bits and pieces of that in all goats, but it's not something I just want to avoid. Those animals that are combining a lot of these aspects and not worry about them. Let's get into these animals that are better made. These animals have to be able to move. They have to look good on the move. That's one of the things that I think from livestock evaluator standpoint, we don't set animals in motion enough. We tend to let them stand there. We let these kids do the outstanding job showing that they do. And we miss things that once that animal gets to moving, we start to see things show up that the showman's been able to show out of them. So look at these animals on the move. Make sure they don't fall apart whenever you set them in motion. All right, next slide. Okay, just these few pictures. This is just a baby kid here. Notice this doe kid. She's a little flat-ribbed. She's really good on her feet and legs, but she's a little flat-ribbed. Next slide, let's look at her again. She's still flat-ribbed. Same goat. She's long-bodied. She's still good on her feet and legs. This particular angle does not show how flat-ribbed she is, but this doe was pretty flat. She just did not have as much volume as I would have liked to have seen. Still a really nice breeding female. She worked with the right bucks. She was a piece of the breeding puzzle, but this particular doe would not stand a chance to this one right here. This is an outstanding female right here. Big rib. She's deep back into her flank. Has a lot of volume, level hip, a lot of muscle. This was the doe that was the letter A in the picture earlier on. Okay? Okay, so I'm not seeing any questions coming along here, but so as we talk about ethics, I'm not going to spend a lot of time on this, but just don't wait till last minute to do things. Honor your tag in dates. Don't switch tags. You don't want to be labeled, well, Wisconsin, they're as bad as those dadgum Texans and the Oklahomans. And, don't worry about those folks down south. And if anybody's from there, just I am too, so I'm just poking at them. No switching tags. Report lost tags to your extension agents or to your ag teachers. They'll get you some replacements. Just really try to follow up with all your on all your rules. Familiarize yourself with those, and do the best you can. Major issues: illegal use of legal drugs, prescription drugs, steroids, analgesics, anesthetics. There's just not a place in the show ring for that. And yes, we know there are a lot of people that do that. But these goats are merely a tool in the way that we raise our children. And I am a firm believer that if we are doing things that are unethical, we are teaching our kids to do that. And that is something that I don't want to have on my conscience as I'm teaching my kid, well, why are you giving them that, Dad? And I have to explain myself. And when you find yourself starting to try to make excuses and you can't just tell them truthfully, there may be something going on there. So we won't dwell on that. And then there's the big one, illegal use of illegal drugs. Just stay away from that. Just do what you can, be as honest as you can, don't let some of this other stuff, get into your show box. Okay. Next slide. Okay. Facilities, very important, but at the same time can be very simple. Yes, it gets cold in Wisconsin. I understand that. So you'll have to have some sheds. I expect y'all are still a little cool up there. It is cool in Kansas right now still. But they primarily need access to shade and sunshine. If you will allow those goats about 15 to 20 square feet of goat or per goat of shed space, you'll be in good shape, well-drained, well-ventilated. But at the same time, not just a where it's breezy all the time. As long as they can escape from rain, then they're a lot better off. Because the last thing you want is a goat that is getting rained on and is the wind's blowing on them. The combination of those two things is really hard on a goat. So we've got to be very careful there. All right, next slide. Fences need to be predator-proof, and so, your fences can be as simple as a 4x4 welded wire panel. They They make them in 4 and 5 foot heights. Me personally, I like the 5 foot panel. I like the higher fence, and they generally come in 16 to 20 foot length. If you want to go to the extra, I wouldn't say expense because they're, I mean, per linear foot, it's probably cheaper, but they make a sheep and goat wire. It's also 4x4, it's 48 inches tall, but it's a field fence. It's not a welded wire panel, but it's a field fence that you can stretch and build some pins out of. And again, I won't say that it'll keep all predators out, but it does a pretty nice job. And it also is one, because of that 4x4 pattern, it won't allow goats to get their heads up. Again, galvanized wire, that's that welded wire panel that I was talking about. You'll see some of those that come in 2x4 inch. I don't think that's necessary. I think that's a little overkill, but I try to avoid cattle panels or what they call the utility panel or combo panel, because the spacing on those is such that a goat can get their head through the fencing and get the head caught. Yeah, can you believe that? So feeders, self feeders, place those about 6 inches off the ground. You know, we got, our goats were born in December, the ones we have now. They were born in December. We picked them up end of March, and they have been on a self feeder, they're still on a self feeder. They've been on self feeder since the day they were born, essentially, or as early as they would eat. And these goats will stay on the self feeder probably until the end of this month or next month. I just try to let my goats grow. I don't try to hold them back. You know, I want them to reach their growth potential, and then I might start toying with their nutrition program a little bit towards the end to monitor what their weights are. But as long as I see that these goats are not getting overly conditioned or too fat, then I will go ahead and let them eat out of a self-feeder. Now, don't think by allowing them to eat out of a self-feeder that you are not supposed to be taking care of them. And so it's one of those types of things that I think you really need to still be out there. Make sure that you're providing fresh feed, and you should be in good shape. All right, so as we look at feed troughs, your feed trough should be hung at the top of the, where the top of the feeder is even with the top of that goat's shoulder. That way they just can reach over in there, get the feed that they need to, and move on. Clean troughs regularly. This will help prevent some diseases, and it will also help them eat better. You can feed them individually or as a group. Right now, the animals are on a self feeder. We feed ours as a group. However, as we transition them off of the self feeder, we have individual feeding pens that we have made that are 1 foot in width and 4 foot in length, and they're just side by side, and there's 6 of them. And so we can feed 6 goats individually at a time. And that works really well, because you can then monitor how much some goats are eating, how much they're not, what goats aren't. Goats have a real tendency not to show you that they're sick. And so it makes it hard to pick some of that up. And so as a result, if a goat didn't eat well that day, go ahead and get a thermometer and check his temperature. And if he's got a temperature above 103, chances are he's running a pretty good fever. And so it's one of those things that you want to be aware of there. And then make them out of metal, plastic, wood, whatever's easiest. Anymore, the livestock supply companies have really done a good job of putting some feeders out there and buckets and things that we can buy that are economical, and we don't have to use this, build so much ourselves, but at the same time, we can buy it for relatively an inexpensive price. And so we want to make sure that we are on go there. My computer locked up for just a second. As we go on, tell me what's on that next slide, just to lead off.
The next slide is water containers.
Okay, so water containers, automatic or manual, those are containers that, you know, I try not to have just a huge trough out there, because otherwise you end up like I did when I was a little kid, and we had automatic waters, and, you know, we didn't have to go check on them near as much, and so they didn't require the cleaning that was really necessary, or they... I didn't clean them as often as they really needed it. And so if you've got a big tub that you use as a water trough, you know, I'd encourage you just to try to identify one. I typically say about 3/4 of a gallon to a gallon per goat per day. And so if you've got 5 goats, get your 5-gallon bucket and fill that full of water, and that should be good, and then check it later on. And a 5-gallon bucket, every time you fill it, rinse it, clean it, and you'll be in good shape. Also, if you've got a automatic trough, make sure that it drains easily, so when you turn it off that you can dump it, or that you can pull the plug on it, and it'll drain easily so you can clean it well. Keep them in the shade. I like to use either a plastic, rubber, or metal container, but I try to keep it in the shade. We have black buckets or black tubs. That's what we use, but our tubs are in the shade. And so I try to avoid black containers if they're going to be anywhere near the sun. Okay? Exercise facility. And honestly, there's... some folks that say, well, you know, this is beyond me, because, you know, this is my very first year, this is my second year. You know, folks, if it's your first or second year, and you're still, if you have a desire to really do your best, you know, I really encourage you to look at an exercise facility. It doesn't have to be elaborate. A track or a road that you can run these animals down. They can either be oval, circular, straight. You can use a net wire, this orange construction fence, just about anything that you can make an enclosure for a goat. And that in and of itself, I guess, is somewhat challenging. But I think you get the gist of what I'm saying. Don't spend a lot of money building a super high-priced track, you know, when something very simple will work. A little girl I helped out in New Mexico the very first year, they figured out that they had a big pecan orchard right behind their house. And so she would put feed out for those goats in the evenings. Those goats knew where the feed was. But she'd hook them to her four-wheeler and use that four-wheeler out, and they get practice leading that way. They had already learned to lead by the time that she hooked them to the four-wheeler. She didn't just do that. But then she'd drive out a certain distance, unhook those goats, and they'd start running as hard as they could back. And especially by the time she turned that four-wheeler around and got behind them and was revving it up, they were really running. But if you're going to do that, be very careful with a four-wheeler, because it's not necessarily safe. You can run over the top of your goat, and so that's not necessarily a good thing. I love a dog. I personally like to use border collies. But if you're going to use a dog in your track program, be very careful with these animals, because they have to be controllable, or otherwise they will eat your goats. At the same time, they have to be a pretty tough dog, because goats will challenge a dog more than any other species that I've ever been around, and they'll have a tendency to want to fight that animal. So so just be aware, there's some things there that you can do. You know, a lot of people are using treadmills, just like in the sheep world. And so if you want to use a treadmill, that's great. But if you have some more questions, just give me a call sometime. But here's a picture of a track. That was some old swimming pool covers that he put around the outside so they couldn't see what was going on the outside. This next picture is going to be a picture of how the pens are set up. So again, doesn't have to be anything real elaborate and fancy. You know, these are just put together with some welded wire. That white pipe fence was already there. He just kind of adapted the situation to what works for him. Okay, next slide. Okay, some of the equipment that you're going to need, stiff brushes to clean water troughs. Okay, you've got to have that. Scales, or just at least access to scales. And so you want to know how those animals are performing. If you have the luxury of weighing those animals once a week, that's great. But if you might be able to weigh them every 2 weeks, that will really help you. Some sort of trimming table, that helps you get them up off the ground and do a lot of preparation there. But it also helps you with teaching those goats to brace. Some electric clippers, syringes, needles, goat blankets. And I had put here and or socks. Folks, it's one of those things, the socks are something that I probably don't use that much anymore in these goats. It just, I've not necessarily seen the demand or the need for them. If it's cool enough, I just put a cover on them. If it's a little warmer, if it's warm enough to just put a sock on them, then I just leave them uncovered. I would actually prefer, believe it or not, to wash that goat again before we go to show ring and just leave him uncovered than I would to put a sock on him. So I would just kind of scratch the tail end of that, just use goat blankets. Now, if you have socks, I wouldn't tell you just throw them in the trash and get rid of them. But at the same time, I just don't really like tight-fitting these tubes on these goats. So let's go ahead. All right, there's a picture of your clippers. That's a Premier set. Well, I started to say Blisters, but I think Wall bought them out. So anyway, there's lots of different clippers that you can have out there. Let's go to that next slide. I don't know how many of you are showing breeding females, but these are some of the clippers that you might use, Andes, the Walls, Osters, and the respective guards. But at the same time, if you have a commercial doe show or you are thinking about putting in a commercial doe show, I really encourage you to just slick shear them, because ultimately we're looking at conformation, we're looking at muscle in these commercial animals. A lot of times what I have seen happen is that we get into fitting contests, more or less, when we leave the hair on those females. And so just to keep everything straight and level for these kids, I really encourage you just to slick shear them. Okay, next slide. Okay, so you've got to have show chains. And I would encourage you, if you would jot this down, if you would go to or do a Google search sometime, market goat showmanship from start to finish. Market goat showmanship from start to finish. I have a picture of a couple of show chains that we make ourselves, and that's something that you can do at home fairly easily. But show chains are a mandatory thing. Halters, I love halters. I actually want our animals to lead as well on a halter as they do on a chain, and vice versa. Hoof trimmers. These goats, when we put them on feed, their feet are going to grow fast. And so we need to be sure that we are trimming their feet. A drench gun. And here's another one of those things that, you know, there's a lot of folks out there that say, you know, drench guns are of the devil and we shouldn't be using drench guns. And, you know, some of you may have that idea as well. And then there's a lot of the shows that say, well, we don't want the drench guns because then, you know, people are going to think that we're doing bad things to them and they're going to sue the show or what have you. I look at it as an educational opportunity, because as we look at these animals, if you've been in the industry or you've shown animals very often, you know, at one point in time, there's one of them or two of them every now and then that just, you get to a show and they won't drink, and you can't put anything in front of them that they will drink. And as dumb as you think that is, that if they're dehydrating and they should be thirsty, that they should drink, they just don't do that. And so that is an opportunity for us to step in with the drench gun and drench those animals. We were at our county fair, and, you know, I took a water cooler with us. Our goats weren't, this one particular goat was dehydrating on us because it was 95 at our county fair. And I just unscrewed the lid of our water cooler there and just started drenching him with water. And so a little girl came up and said, "What are you doing?" And so I explained the situation and what we were doing. And so it's as much of an animal welfare issue to help the animals as it is that we're, is perceived sometimes that we're hurting the animals. And so just don't ram the drench gun down the throat and get mad, you know, just handle them like they should be. Portable feed troughs that you can take with you easily to show. A lot of people that I've seen are now carrying a small welded wire panel with them that these little troughs that have these clips on them can clip to. That way, regardless of what the show pins are that you go to, you can take some zip tie that to the fence, and you can use the exact same troughs that those animals are used to eating out of at home. Feed and water buckets, again, I am a big stickler in that the less change, the least amount of change that you can have from the time you leave the house to the time you get to the show, the better off you are. So I like to use the same water bucket, same feed bucket, same everything I can in order to show those animals. And then a soft brush for grooming and brushing those goats. So, okay, next slide. There's just a picture of a good hoof trimmer. They make a set now that are stainless steel. They have a red handle. And there's actually another set out, there's just a little longer, they have a white handle. Those that are stainless steel, I love them. They seem to hold the edge better. They're a little more durable than what these particular blades are. As sharp as these are, those stainless ones are every bit as sharp and just more durable. So I like those, and they just come out the last couple of years. Okay, next slide. Tattoos, if you're tattooing animals, you've got a tattoo outfit. Let's go on to the next slide. Keep going. Okay, you know, we've got these nice metal show boxes that hang on the fence and you can lock, and you know what? Our show box consists of a tote or a couple of totes that we bought at Walmart. And my wife is a 31 consultant, and so she has all these 31 bags that have all of our towels and everything else in there. And so we throw them in those two totes, and we go to the show. So we don't worry a lot about show box, and we get everything done. So that's certainly an optional thing. I really like having a hot air blow dryer, just something that I can dry those goats quickly, if it's allowed. We've got a couple of shows in Kansas that don't allow us to use blowers. And so for those shows, we take a lot of extra towels. Portable livestock scales, if you have them, I mean, that's a plus. Extension cords, muzzle. Some shows don't like you to use muzzle. If you are going to a show and they don't want you to use muzzle, then I really encourage you to bed those animals on whatever bedding that they're going to be bedded on when you get to that particular show. Because what you're going to get into is those animals are going to have a tendency to want to eat the shavings and stuff. So as we look at electric fans to keep things blown, and then we will also have a disbudding iron if you're raising animals that you want to disbud those kids. All right, next slide. Okay, so we'll go through a few of these health issues right quick. Again, here's my pet disclaimer. I am an extension specialist, but I work very closely with a number of veterinarians to make sure that we're talking about the best treatment for these animals possible. And so we don't want to give you any bad information. And so there again, try, do your best to have a relationship with your veterinarian. And I know that there's several folks that say, well, I don't have a good goat veterinarian in my area. That's okay. You know, oftentimes, if you work with those veterinarians, they will help you out. If you discuss things with them, they'll do their best to get along with you. Okay, next slide as we go through these. So overeating, this is one of the most common diseases that we get into with goats. One of the best ways to prevent this is a CDMT vaccination. I say T, we'll get to that in a minute, but it just comes all in one. And so this is one of those things that I really encourage you as a producer to have two vaccinations in those kids prior to selling them. I like to give one at 2 weeks and at 6 weeks of age, and then again at 10 weeks. Once these goats have had three doses, I feel pretty safe. But again, from a veterinarian's perspective that I visited with, Dr. Vanoy, he really encourages, give them one time a month for up to 5 months. Symptoms that they're going to have, diarrhea, you can give them a clostridium antitoxin, but they're rarely ever going to recover. Right here, that second point, prevention, that right there is going to save you in the long run. Be sure that those animals are vaccinated. Okay? Acidosis, be sure your feed room is locked tight. Double lock it, double snap it, do everything you can, because we know goats are Houdinis and can find their way into anything. And so we just want to make sure that we don't get these animals too much starch at one time. We want to have some roughage available to them. One thing that we try to do with our particular goats is we try to give them a handful of alfalfa hay every other day per goat, just to keep their bellies working good. But we just want to make sure they don't get too much grain. Now, if you've gone and you're late getting in from baseball practice or school, or it's dark, it's 10 o'clock, you're past the feeding time, don't go out there and double feed them. In fact, at that point in time, late hour, I might feed a half feeding and then feed a full feeding the next morning. But don't double feed an animal just because you missed a feeding or anticipate another missing a feeding. Just you get into some more chances of creating some health issues that way. Again, you're going to see these animals. They're not going to have much of an appetite. They're going to be lethargic. Your treatment is going to be antacids, oral tetracyclines, probiotics, because those bugs in the gut have been killed off. You want to give them some thiamine. Again, animals can recover, but you've got to have early treatment. You've got to recognize it early on. So if they've gotten in the feed pen or the feed room, you better take some pretty aggressive action quickly. Coccidiosis, this is one of those diseases that we really shouldn't run into that much of a problem with if we're keeping our pens clean and our feed troughs clean, because it's a parasite that's actually found in the digestive tract of the goat, and it's always there, but we just don't want to get it to the point where it's really high levels. But it comes from when we're feeding animals in these dirty troughs or on the ground, and they're just essentially eating their own manure. And so we want to be sure that we're keeping things clean. If we do that, most of the time you're in good shape. If you've got a coccidia stat in your feed, such as monensin or remensin decoconate, those types of things certainly help. And then if you do get into an issue where you do have coccidia, then some cord would sure help you out in that. Again, most of these products are going to be extra label use, but you know that they're all we have at this point in time. And so there again, just work with your veterinarians on this, and you can help these animals heal up. Okay. One more thing on the cord is can put two of them in the water, but they typically just don't like the flavor of it. It's not that appealing to them. So it's best and it's more accurate in terms of dosage if you go ahead and drench those animals with it. Okay, so internal parasites. These are your Moncus contortus, your stomach worms, those types of things. Typically picked up while they're eating grasses or hay out on pasture. Once you get those animals in the pen, if you deworm those animals with ivermectin or valbazin, something like that, typically you're going to be in good shape. You won't have to deworm those animals. You shouldn't have to deworm them again the rest of the year if they're in the pen and you're not letting them forage on the ground a lot. If you're feeding them hay, feed them in different locations around the pen and you'll be in good shape, especially if they're eating it all and not getting manure in that feed, in that hay, and laying in it and then coming back and picking at it later on. Okay, so we won't necessarily worry about floppy kid. I want to comment a little bit ketosis. If you are raising your own breeding animals and you get them too fat, you really get into a problem with ketosis. So again, just keep those animals in nice, good shape, but not overly conditioned. Okay, next slide. Tetanus. Okay, so I talked about CDMT. Vaccination and this is tetanus and most of the time you know, we wouldn't anticipate anything needing a tetanus shot, but if you are going to give a vaccination, might as well go ahead and give it to them. You never know when a goat, as we've talked about before, they are capable of doing anything, and just about the time you think you've got your goat pen baby proofed and ready to go, they're going to find a wire to get hooked in their mouth and stuck. And next thing you know, you're going to the vet to have this wire removed. And so you want to make sure that they do have that tetanus shot. It's one of those things, if they do get tetanus and they haven't had the proper vaccine, rarely again do they ever recover. But like I say, most of the goats that you should be buying are most likely have been vaccinated, and be sure that you're asking the buyer or the seller what those goats have been vaccinated, what they've been dewormed with. Those are some important questions that you might need to ask. Okay, next slide. Floor mouth. This is one of those issues that some areas of the country have more problems than others, and I'm not sure how much y'all deal with this in Wisconsin, but sore mouth is part of pox family, pox virus, and if you're a breeder and you have problems with this every year and it's a fairly significant level, then I would say vaccinate. If not, if you're having one or two symptoms or two cases a year, I don't think it's to the point that you really need to worry about it, because once you start vaccinating with it, this is a modified live virus, and it's going to create a scab, and that scab's going to fall in the soil, and then it's going to be there forever. And so if you can keep from doing that, I think you're better off. However, if you have a goat that gets sore mouth, don't go out with a steel brush or razor blade or something to start cutting at them and scraping them off and spraying them with iodine thinking you're helping them. I mean, if you had a fever blister, how would you like for somebody to come along there, here, let me get this steel brush and I'm going to scrape on it a little bit and I'm going to shoot a little bit of iodine on there and it'll make you all better. I think you'd knock that person out if they came at you with something like that. And so these goats, we want to do the same thing and take care. You know, it's going to clear up within about 3 to 4 weeks. Just give them some time, and I think everything will be fine. Ringworm. As we look at ringworm and fungus, as Dr. Van Noy quoted one time, this is a vet I grew up around, he said, you know, we've used everything with the exception of the atomic bomb on this stuff, and we can't figure out how to kill it. There's several antifungal products out there that we might want, that you can use and spray down the animals after you've shown. Take them to the wash rack, wash them down, spray them with antifungals, put them back on the trailer. If you're just going jackpot shows, or spring shows, just kind of for fun shows that you're not going to be there overnight. Show off the tighter if you can. It'll be the best thing for you. If you have had it, take a lot of bleach and fungicides and spray down your place, spray down your trailers, and that'll help you out. Animals will recover, but there's no instant cure. If you have an animal that has a problem, please don't take them to the show. It's just going to create a problem for somebody else, and you get upset. Urinary calculi. Those of you that are feeding goat feed, be sure if you're feeding a goat, you should be feeding a goat feed. Don't feed them horse and mule feed. Don't feed them sheep feed. Feed them goat feed. But look at the calcium phosphorus ratio. We would want it to be a minimum 2-to-1. It can be sometimes as much as 4-to-1. The key component of this is phosphorus. And if you look at a feed tag, it's going to say phosphorus, and over on the side, it's going to say minimum. And so that means, obviously, there could be more than that particular number in the feed. But make sure that that number is no larger than 0.40%. If you're at 0.38, that's more ideal. But if you've got a feed that you're looking at, and that feed tag says 0.55 phosphorus, 0.60 phosphorus, you are asking for trouble with urinary calculi. We still don't know all the ins and outs of it, and I'm actually doing a research study on some different urinary acidifiers. Currently, we just finished a project, first leg of a project on Wednesday, and so this is something we're looking at, but we still haven't figured it out yet. But we do know that that the base phosphorus level is a critical piece of this. And so what's that? And also, we for years we said, well, if you're feeding ammonium chloride in your feed, then you should be fine. But something that I've learned just in the last 3 or 4 years is that the animal actually responds and adjusts for the amount of ammonium chloride in the feed. And so it's one of those things that it's not an end-all cure-all, if you know what I mean. Treatment, if you've got an animal that I tell my kids whenever they go to the barn, you need to be looking and making sure those goats pee and that the stream is steady from belly to ground. If they're dribbling, if they're running or grinding their teeth or anything like that, showing you any signs of discomfort while they're urinating, you need to be on the lookout for urinary calculi and call your vet immediately. Sometimes it's just as simple as snipping the urethral process off the end of the penis, and that way that goat can pee. Sometimes those stones will settle in the end there. And then sometimes you get into some areas where you need to treat with methogel or ammonium chloride, slurry, those types of things can generally help get that goat urinating again. Okay, next slide. Pink eye, it's just like what we experience with pink eye. It can either be a chlamydia or mycoplasm, so treatment is going to depend on one or the other, and so contact your veterinarian again, and they'll be able to help you out. We've dealt with very little pink eye in our goats. We had a little spell with our goats at Penn State, but nothing in our show goats we've ever had problems with.
Okay, Brian, if it's okay, if I could just jump in here, and we're about 20 after or so, and I thought this might be a good time to kind of ask for some questions from folks.
Sure.
Because I'm Brian's got a wealth of great slides, and we're certainly not going to be able to get through all of them this evening. But I felt this might be a good spot to ask questions because I do want to end with just a few thoughts on sportsmanship with our youth specialist, Pam. So, Brian, just to start off, a question that I get often is you talked a little bit about nutrition in terms of feeding, you know, sheep feed or goat feed. Is there any precautions that people should be aware of in terms of different sheep and goat feed if folks have both sheep and goats on their farm? Do you know about that a bit?
It's safer from the standpoint of the goat eating sheep feed than the sheep eating goat feed, because most goat feeds are formulated with goats have a copper requirement very similar to that of cattle. And as we know on the sheep side, sheep and copper are not good friends. And so we want to make sure that if you are feeding a feed or a mineral to your goats that is formulated for them, that you're not feeding them also to sheep. And that's the advantage that we have. I mean, we show lambs as well, and our lambs are penned with our goats. But when we put them in their individual feeders, the lambs are getting lamb feed, the goats are getting goat feed. And that's sometimes challenge to feed them individually, but it's one of those things that, that you may have to do anyway.
Hey, any other questions for Brian here as we move to sportsmanship and to Pam, if this is an okay spot, Brian? I know you're waiting for your son from T-ball as well.
Oh, sure, sure. Well, actually, it's my littlest little girl. She hopped in, and she's been sitting here waiting patiently.
Okay. Any questions from you all out there? You can unmute your phone and ask Brian a question, or if you've got a question that you'd like to ask in the chat box, go ahead and do that. Because I think once we move to Pam, I'm sure Brian's going to need to get off and manage his family at this point. Any questions for Brian?
And there's a lot of other things in there in nutrition and showmanship and things that if anybody ever has any questions about, just feel free to give me a shout.
Yeah, when I do put this information online, and we'll go to that where that will be here at the end, Brian, I will share your email address if that's all right, and folks can contact you, and this I think this PowerPoint has done a nice job in terms of being able to show some of those other things. And those of you who are on tonight, make sure you do the evaluation this evening. That will help us too to be able to hopefully invite Brian again and maybe have another part two to the webinar for all the other good information he can share with us too.
So, you bet. I'd love to do it from my end.
All right. Well, we appreciate you coming on, Brian, this evening. And again, like I said, I owe you dinner when we hopefully will be able to run the Skillathon contest in Louisville this fall. So I appreciate you joining and helping us out in Wisconsin on Meat Goat.
Absolutely. It's my pleasure, Bernie.
All right. Thanks, Brian. So, Pam.
Good luck to all of you with your goat projects.
All right. Thanks so much, Brian.
You bet.
Pam, are you on this evening? Do you want to wrap us up into sportsmanship and to kind of talk through that very important aspect of our project?
Sure. I'm glad to do that. I'm Pam Hobson. I'm the Ag and Animal Science Forage Development State Specialist. And I'm going to talk just briefly here about sportsmanship because I know we're getting close to the end of our time here. And when I look at it, sportsmanship, what is it? Well, oftentimes some people, when they're showing their animals, whether it's a meat goat or any other animal, they think about it only in the showmanship classes. And I like to think about it, it's during all the time that you're working with your animal and your project. I kind of like to think about it as the golden rule. Do unto others as you have them do unto you. If it's something that you feel comfortable doing, and if you would like to have someone say that or do that to you, then you're probably a good sportsman. If you're not, then maybe you need to stop and think about it a little bit. If we go to the next slide, some of the things about conduct becoming to an individual involving, and we're going to talk about these a little bit more later, go into a little bit more in depth, fairness and honest competition, courtesy, and graceful acceptance of the results. So if we go to the next slide, we'll go into them a little bit more in depth. Conduct. High personal standards of behavior as you represent your family, your club, your community. Whenever you're out showing your animal, you're representing all of those groups. And if you're going on to the state level, you may be representing your county. Or if you're going on to a national show, you may be representing your state. So remember, it's not just you. You're representing yourself as well as your family and other organizations that you're a part of that helps you be able to show in those different shows. Fairness, and I think Brian and Bernie both talked about this a little bit, about learn what the rules are and understand the rules. I would encourage you every year to check the rules, because every once in a while something changes, and so make sure you do that. be objective, be honest. Honesty is always one of those things. Is the best policy when you're thinking about whether you're evaluating yourself and your project animal, as well as others, others' project animal as well. For honesty, integrity. One of the things here, it says do your own work. And I think we have to take that into perspective as well. If you're, this is your first year member, you're probably not going to be able to do all your work. But it is a family project and you work together. And then as you grow older, I know when we were doing one of these other ones, one of the presenters said, you know, when I was young, my mom and dad helped me. Now I go into the house and ask, can you come out and help me do this? Maybe this is something that takes two people or whatever. So judge that by your age as well. Be truthful and fair and straightforward with everything that you say and do. So just keep in mind part of that golden rule. What makes a good sport? There's competition. Understand when you're going into a competition that everybody wants the same results. They all want to be winners. But, you know, we know that there's probably only one grand champion meat goat. And so there are going to be winners and losers. So think about that when you're going into the contest. Courtesy. Be courteous to yourself, your other competitors. Also think about spectators and the people that they're watching you. I know someone said something, don't do anything that grandma wouldn't like to hear from you. So do that. And then think about, thank your leaders and people that helped you get where you're at. And sometimes, you know, it's okay. And most judges welcome asking questions. And that's great to do that. But if it's a question that you're, don't get emotional about it. Stop and take a few minutes and then go talk to the judge. Graceful acceptance of results. Again, you know, not everybody's going to win. And, you know, if you don't win that day, I always like to think about it as the judges. It's one person's opinion on one day. And if you're on the circuit and you're showing more than one time that animal, sometimes your competitor might win and sometimes you might win. So be graceful if you do win, but then congratulate. If you don't win that time, congratulate your competitor. And again, thank everybody that helped you. If we go to the next slide, just a little quote here that I found that I think kind of wraps up some of the things with sportsmanship. It's your response to winning and losing that makes you a winner or a loser. And if you think about this, if you respond well about the winning or you're losing, and if you don't, that can make you a winner or a loser in life. So what we're looking at here is one show, one part of our life, but it'll work on our life all around. And remember, again, the golden rule. And, you know, sportsmanship, it's not just for the showmanship contest. It is for everything that we do, not only with our project animals, but everything we do in life. So practice it today and every day. And like the old saying goes, practice makes perfect. So the more you practice your sportsmanship, the better you'll get at it. And if there's no other questions on that, I know I went through it really quickly, but I know we were running out of time. So unless there's a question, I'll hand it back to you, Bernie.
Okay, thanks, Pam. So Pam's a great resource as it relates to youth livestock animal projects. She's in the 4-H department, but definitely has a degree in animal science and is very knowledgeable in this area. So some additional resources that you might find helpful are listed here. If you go to the website again, as I, you know, get more connections and work with more folks that have meat goats in that interest, we'll certainly be building more of those resources available for folks. And definitely this is a new and fun evolving project. I have a son that's interested in starting in this area and project as well. So I think, like Brian said, it's a very manageable project and they're kind of built for our kids. So they're nice and smaller and very manageable for some as compared to maybe some of the larger projects like these in others. And perhaps maybe not quite the investment financially for some families that makes it more doable and more interesting as compared to other projects. So again, I appreciate you coming on board and listening this evening. If you could go online and for sure do our evaluation, that would be certainly helpful for us as we plan forward. For sure, if you're interested in more information about MECOS or having Brian back on again as it relates to more aspects of the MECO project, please certainly do share that in the evaluation. And this evaluation link is also within the email that I sent you this evening or today. So please go ahead online and do that. Again, I don't know how this went this evening unless you go online and state your thoughts. So I appreciate you taking just a few seconds to do that. We'll end this evening. I appreciate you being online. Hopefully summer, spring, whichever it decides to be at this point, hopefully summer decides to show up for all of us and our animal projects to grow this summer. Good luck this summer in your projects and have a great evening. Thank you.